They think the turnout was around 64-65%, which is lower than what they had been pushing for. The Russian government had, according to reports that they did not deny, they had a goal of 70% of the vote, which they got, it looks like, but they wanted 70% turnout, and they didn't get that. And that's despite the fact that they tried really hard. They had things like food sales. They apparently, a lot of employers were telling their employees, you have to go out and vote, and we want proof. So people were taking selfies of themselves at polling stations, because the Russian government knew this was going to be a boring election for the Russians. All the candidates running against Putin, seven of them were pre-approved. The guy who wasn't approved had been calling for a boycott, so they knew some people would be paying attention to him. But on balance, it's good news for Putin.
What does that actually mean? I mean, is this enables him to do what with this political capital from this election?
Well, I think it enables him to continue doing what he's doing, which is, you know, clamp down on Russia internally. There's been a lot of, you know, from the perspective of your business folks, what are they looking at? Internally in Russia, the government has been slowly, steadily creeping down on internet privacy. Well, there was no privacy probably to begin with, but clamping down on internet commerce, what the Russian people can see. Of course, the television is completely under Russian control. So he'll continue to consolidate domestically. I think he'll be a little bit worried because the turnout demonstrates some apathy, and that could easily turn to opposition. And so what he's going to try to do, unfortunately for us, I think he's going to be pretty aggressive. He's going to continue to be as aggressive as he's been thus far internationally.
Domestically, how does Putin combat apathy?
Well,
it doesn't really
again,
matter in a dictatorship.
Yeah, well, what he does is he shows that there's an external force that needs to be combated. He needs to defend the Russian people against the West. So while we see very clearly that Putin is actually attacking us, attacking our elections, spreading fake news through Facebook and other vehicles, obviously he actually attacked some of our military personnel in Syria. He tells the Russian people, no, it's the other way around, that the West is out to get Russia. He believes that we want to change the regime. We want to push him out of power in Moscow. And so all this aggression is aimed at, you know, keeping us out and keeping us weak.
Are you worried perhaps that this may make Putin a little bit more aggressive or belligerent? I mean, when he had low poll numbers, I believe, the last election, but that was before Ukraine. And then Ukraine really pushed him over the edge in terms of popularity. Could you see a scenario like that unfolding again?
Yes, so they actually timed the elections to coincide with the anniversary of taking over Crimea again. So that big military effort that caused his popularity to soar up to 80% and more. I think from the perspective of the markets, what your people should be thinking about, your viewers, things are not going to get better between the U.S. and Russia in the near term. We're going to continue to have as much tension as we've had. I think we need to be firm so that Putin doesn't continue to be as aggressive as he's been. But, you know, as far as sanctions are concerned, I would expect them to be ratcheted up. They're pretty light if you compare them to the sanctions we have on North Korea or the sanctions we had before on Iran. So I think they're going to continue to ratchet up. Congress will be looking at this. They'll look at banking sanctions. You know that Theresa May, when she gave her statement last week, you know, saying that they were going to expel the 23 Russian diplomats, she said there's more to come. And I think that she's talking to the U.S. and other allies about what more is to come.
It's interesting that in these large jurisdictions like China and Russia, the thing that is really starting to happen is the elimination of term limits. That's really what I've noticed over the last decade. And I'm just wondering if that's something that we might see happen here domestically one day. What do you think? I mean, that's really the big change over there, and China, too.
Yes, your analysis is spot on. When he said, oh, we're getting rid of the term limits in China, the world got a little nervous, but by and large, he'll be fine. I mean, he's not going to suffer any big pushback. And I'm sure the Russian president noticed that. And though they have tried to hew closely to their constitution, they have hewed to it more or less, although, you know, it was a farcical turnover between him and Medvedev, the current prime minister, who was president in between the two terms that Putin has. But Putin said when he was asked actually directly by the press yesterday, will you eliminate the term limits? He said, not yet. Yet. So yet is the operative word.
Hey there, thanks for checking out CNBC on YouTube. Be sure to subscribe to stay up to date on all of the day's biggest stories. You can also click on any of the videos around me to watch the latest from CNBC. Thanks for watching.